Thank you all for coming. A little matter of housekeeping first. We want to thank our sponsors, MIG, T-Wall, and State Bank Across Plains, because they are paying for the drinks and the food tonight. Anyway, the way this is going to work, each of the candidates, Hans Silbert, Gertie Brahr, I'm not going to introduce them very much. Gertie Brahr, Alderman for District 2, Hans Silbert, Alderman for District 7. They've both served with distinction on the City Council for a long time. They're each going to make an opening statement, and I'm going to ask some questions. They each going to answer the same questions. And at some point, they are going to be allowed to ask each other questions. And we'll open it up to questions from the floor. So if you have questions that you would ask the aldermen, either one of them or both of them, it's up to you. You can do that as well. We flipped a coin. Who went first? You won.
Yes.
So you can make your opening statement first.
Okay.
Gertie Brahr.
Hello, friends. How are you today? I'm happy to be here with you. Let me share a little bit my personal history, my contribution to Middleton community, and my leadership plans for the city. First, about my personal history. I grew up on a farm in a village, small village in India. I was the first in my family to go to school, college, and then the university. 46 years ago, I came to the University of California, Riverside, to pursue my PhD in genetics. That's where I met my wife, and we have been married for over 40 years. About 34 years ago, with my wife and two children, I moved to Middleton. This has been a wonderful place to raise a family and to live and raise a family. Both our children went to our public schools, which are great schools here, graduating in 98 and 2000. Middleton has truly awesome teachers. I worked as a senior scientist at AgriCetus and retired after 21 years of research in plant biotechnology. Now a little bit about my contribution to the Middleton community. For 30 years, I have played leadership roles in serving our public schools, Boy Scout, youth soccer, Middleton Outreach Ministry, and United Way. I have served on the board of trustees and a president of Good Neighbor, Middleton Good Neighbor Festival. I co-founded Defense of Cattle Ponds, a conservancy group. I'm a Middleton Kwanian and have served as a club president, lieutenant governor, and a governor of Wisconsin Upper Michigan District. I started Kwana's leadership club called Tea Club at Middleton High School. Now with over 200 members, it's the largest tea club in whole of Wisconsin. So finally, about my leadership plans for the city. I have represented District 2 for nearly 9 years. To do this effectively, I go around my district and talk to the citizens and respond to their needs. I was instrumental in starting the Sustainability Committee in 2008. I'm running for mayor to serve the community I love. Mayor's big responsibilities are public safety, economic development, and the quality of life. I will work to fix our roads and keep our taxes affordable. I will focus to maintain our parks, ponds, trails, and nature conservancy, which we all love. My passion is to serve people. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You guys are great.
So My name is Hans Hilbert. I've served on the Middleton City Council for the last 10 years. I've served on the Plan Commission as the council's representative since 2010. I was born and raised. I'm the only candidate in this election that was born and raised and has grown up in this city. I went to Middleton schools. I graduated Middleton High School in 2002. I have a unique situation that all throughout my education and before I left Middleton to go up to UW-Stevens Point for college, I got to live in the same house. That house had a bedroom window that was mine that looked out over what's now the Bach Community Forest. My front yard was the Pheasant Bands Conservancy. And that's really what got me involved in giving back to the community. I'm the only candidate in this election that has the endorsement of 16 past and present Middleton City Council members. Middleton has a history of having aldermen and alderwomen that serve on the council for many years, for many terms. To get to 16 of them to endorse me, that's a lot of individuals that have given a lot of their time to the community. They know that I am going to do a great job as being mayor because they've seen me work to make the city of Middleton a better place. As a mayor, I promise I'm going to start with continuing to protect the natural resources, Pheasant Branch Conservancy, Lake Mendota, our kettle ponds. Because we protect our natural resources, that's going to allow us to prosper with economic development that allows us to maintain a stable tax base so that when you get your tax bills in December, you're not surprised. You'll know that it will be very similar to what it was in years in past, but you'll also know that you'll be getting better city services and more city services for the same values. That type of planning is going to allow future generations to want to live and work in Middleton. And I want to keep the introduction brief so that we can answer as many questions tonight as you may have and that George is going to ask. Thank you.
All right, my first question is for Hans. Well, for both of you, but you'll answer it first. What qualities do you think a mayor should have?
The word persuade sometimes gets a negative connotation with it, but I think it's really the job of a mayor to be able to persuade a council, a community, and the city staff to all move forward in the same direction. To value the city's goals, to value the city's objectives, and to always keep in sight what those are and have a plan for how to get there. The ability to work with developers, with business owners, with residents, those are all very important things that a mayor needs to be able to do. The mayor also has to be able to sit down and eat a meal with somebody and have a good laugh. Go out after a city council meeting to the Village Green and have a beer and talk about the community when it's not a vote for this or that. I think that a mayor that has all of those qualities is destined to do a really good job, and I know that I can offer those abilities.
Thank you. Gurdeep?
Thank you. Well, the way I look at the mayor is, mayor has to represent the whole city, has to represent the whole, all the people in the city. So I think the mayor has to be a people person. I am that. So then the mayor has to have the ability to, of course, work with the other elders and the city staff. And I will be, as a mayor, working with all the other elders as well as the city staff. And we have a wonderful city staff. So the mayor has to have a vision for the whole city and looking 5, 10, or 15, or 20 years out into the future. And we have to really see that the way the technology is evolving, that where this whole country and where this technology is going, where Middleton will be going. So with my science background as a scientist and my working with the community for 30 years, it provides me the insights that where this city wants to go, and also I will be able to attract some of the technologies company to come here to Middleton. So we will have a very vibrant city, and we will be setting goals for our children and grandchildren. I know it's probably after the city council meeting, maybe a good idea to come to the village green and have a drink with other people. I haven't done in the past, but I can learn those things. I can have those drinks as well. And it's just when you are an elder man, your responsibility is for your district. When you are a mayor, your responsibility is the whole city. So you have to look for the whole city at that time. You have to work with all the elders, even though if you didn't get along earlier. And that's how I look for it. And I will make a great mayor, and I would like your support. Thank you.
All right, next question. Gertie, we just heard about the qualities that a mayor should have. Do you think your opponent has those qualities?
Hans is a nice guy, and I think he's young, and he has a lot to learn, and I admire and respect him.
Hans, do you think your opponent has those qualities?
I don't think that he has the qualities to be the mayor when you list those qualities. I think he's demonstrated over the last 9 years that he's better at putting up walls, getting in the way of progress, being difficult, and not working with others. I think he's made people feel uncomfortable, and in the role of mayor, I think it would be a devastation to the city for that to be the public image, to be a welcoming community to new residents, to the current residents, and to businesses that want to locate here. I think it'd be very difficult for him to learn those qualities. These are qualities I already exhibit.
I will let the people be the judge. Yes. Okay. I have been, if I could, just for 10 seconds.
No, we don't have rebuttals. Right. You can do that later. question 3 to Hans. What in your opinion, are the city of Middleton's biggest challenges?
Right now, there's two challenges that the city of Middleton faces, and I like to describe one of them as being an internal problem, and that's internal to the organization of the city of Middleton. And it's continuing to operate as the city, providing the great public services and trying to add additional public services that our residents are asking for, while remaining under the state-imposed levy cap. The city of Middleton is in a unique position because of the great work that I've worked towards along with the rest of the council members over the last 10 years to have economic development in a tough time. But we've been so successful that even if we collect more money from the entire tax base and your tax bills go down, we're still capped at how much we can collect. And it makes it very difficult to match the rising insurance costs, to match the fact that road repair costs more in any given year, to add city staff to address more needs. So I'm looking forward to working extremely hard for everybody in this room to find new revenue sources, to create public and private partnerships that bring in new revenue that don't burden the levy. It's going to take a lot of work. We have great examples in the city already that I've worked towards where we've seen this happen, and we can do that going forward. The other is more of a external issue to the city as a whole, and it's the workforce housing gap. We have 20,000 people that come into the city of Middleton for a job, and most of those individuals cannot afford to buy a home here or to rent a home here. The number one thing that we can do as a community is have the workforce also be community members when they go home at night. It touches on every aspect of society and will cause our community to grow. When we have the employment but not the housing or not the affordability of that housing, we have a workforce housing gap. There's two ways to close in on that gap. The easy one is working with developers to provide a full spectrum of housing opportunities across the board. The other is economic development to bring up the wages of the service industry. And I'm looking forward to working hard on that.
Gertie, what are the challenges?
Well, I guess everybody sitting in this room knows the biggest challenge is roads. When you come from Madison to Middleton, you don't need to look at the sign, you can tell whether it's a Gammon Road, whether it's the University Avenue, or whether it's some of the other roads. So the very first, we have neglected our roads for way too long. We have to fix our roads. And I have gone around, as I do, in the neighborhood and asking people what is our biggest challenge. And that is something to be number one. And the next challenge is that, Hans is interested in having more taxes. I don't want to say anything negative, but I think these schools and the other cities, they have learned to live with their means. Now we have reached the levy cap, but there are some other, as the properties appreciating, we still will be having higher revenue. So that's not as big a question. So what is important is that when I talk to some of the people who are retired, who are in limited income, that they are wondering that are their taxes going to be keep going up, or there's going to be some sort of where they can afford to live in this town, so in this city. So I think it was wonderful that some of our taxes went down this year because of some of the TIF area was put into general obligation bonds, and we have some more money. But our taxes for a year before, they went up by 12, mill rate went up by 12.5%, and year before was 8%. And you have to see that what your inflation rate is, and it was much, much higher than inflation. So we have to provide quality services, and you can do that, but you also have to be able to ensure that the people who have been living here for a long, long time and they have limited income, they should be able to live here. So, and the third point is that, yes, we have a problem with affordable housing. This is not just the Middleton problem, it's a county-wide problem. And Middleton is working on that. And by the way, Hans Hilbert voted against one of the affordable housing units, which is the Meadow Ridge Apartments. And he also voted, I'm not absolutely certain, I think he also voted against the heritage housing as well, both affordable housing. So yes, affordable housing, that's it. Number one, roads. Number two, keep our expenses in control. And number three, go for affordable housing as well. And nature, let's maintain our nature conservancy as for our children and grandchildren.
Next question.
Yeah.
Those challenges that you just listed, how would you propose to deal with them as mayor?
Number one, the roads. It's
now.
Yes, we should start fixing them now. So what the city is doing and has been doing is chip sealing, and then this is the least expensive option, and it covers a lot of area. It's sort of keeps the road in sort of stable shape for some time. It only helps the roads which are already in good shape. It does not fix the roads like Gammon Road. So we are wasting money, which the roads which are less than the pacer rating of, which are really so bad that you can't really fix them. And the second thing which the city has been doing is rebuilding completely, so which is also very expensive. So what the city has to start doing, and we will start doing when I'm here, is that it's called million overlay. That means you remove a layer of it and then you refill it. So you come up with a very nice road and a surface, and then that is going to last for a long time. So this is one thing here, that how we are going to go for the roads. I actually have a 5-point plan for how we are going to go after fixing our roads. So number one is that just like our health issues, you know, you got to have the prevention and maintenance. And this is some of the things which even our neighboring city Madison is doing. So when the roads are still good, whenever there's even the smallest problem, go and fix it. And actually, you know, Middleton is going to start doing it. And the second will be the million overlay. And third will be that only, do the third part, which as the last choice. And the cost-wise, when you rebuild the road, if it costs you $20, it costs you only $4 for million overlay. So you can do 5 times more of the road than otherwise. So then in the end, since the roads are so bad, we may have to borrow some money, but you have to remember that we had the opportunity.
We cannot hear you back here at all. Can't hear anything. If you guys could stand in the middle. We cannot hear a thing that you guys are saying. So we, this half might as well leave.
Carry on.
Well, I will try to speak even louder. And the second part was, controlling our expenses. And I think that is, as a mayor, you set the priorities, you make a differentiation between the needs and wants. And the third is about the affordable housing. And I actually have voted for it, and I will vote going forward for the affordable housing.
For the people sitting up front here, if there's people with real good ears, that we can make this work, we can all get really friendly and move your chairs forward if you can't hear. We have some recording equipment. This will be on the city channel. We got the microphone for that, so there'll be an opportunity to hear through that. I appreciate everybody coming out.
Come on down, take my seat.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
There's one up here too. Come on down. It's all right.
I'm going to, as people move, I'm going to try to answer that question. I think you can start my 3 minutes now. And I'm going to talk about roads because Gertie failed to mention that we already have a system in place for how we're going to repair our roads. We have a system where city staff went out and rated every single one of our roads and what condition it is in. We know exactly which ones need to be rebuilt with a million overlay. We know which ones that we can put a chip seal on and have 10 more years of life out of those roads. What the problem with roads is funding them. We've had reduced state aid, and it's not the city's responsibility to put it on the tax base to fix all those roads. We need to climb the ladder and get the funding back. But it doesn't change how we're going to fix those roads. When politicians like Gertie Brar pick one road because it's in their district and put it as a higher priority, like Middleton Street, it takes away from the ability for the city to follow the technical process of where we should be fixing roads to extend the life of them, saving money over time in the long term. When you make decisions like that, it all falls apart. He says he's a scientist. He should know that, but he doesn't. He doesn't exhibit the skills of the long-range vision of what the finances and the community should look like. It's very clear when he answers questions like that. I had a road, it was probably the worst road, and you're all going to argue with me because the one in front of your house is even worse. Valley Ridge Road. I inherited a road that was not rebuilt for 20 or 30 years. Why? Because we didn't understand fully the long-term planning of growth to the northeast with the sewer underneath the road. And it would be a very expensive project to put a new road in, then dig it all up again to put a new pump in. I begged neighbors. I stood in the middle of Valley Ridge Road and got screamed at because there were potholes. And I took that because I knew it was going to be better for the entire community if we just waited till we had the right answers so that we could stay on track with repairing the roads in the way that we needed to. He says he's got a five-point plan, and I didn't hear anywhere where funding was answered. If you're going to, building roads is easy. You borrow money, you put it as a capital expense, you hope you have enough engineering staff to make the design, you put out the bid and you pay for it. You pay it off in 10 years, but when you do that, the debt service gets passed on to the tax bill. He doesn't want taxes to go up, but he's saying that he's going to do that by building roads.
Okay, guys, this is how the roads budget went here, up and down. When I'm a mayor, there will be a stable budget. We will know what...
30. Excuse me, you can do that when you get your chance.
I do have a more specific question. There's been discussion in recent weeks about a public plaza next door here, four properties to the west of the Village Green. What is your position on the public plaza, Hans?
Boy, it would be a great asset to the community. And if you read the Middleton Review, you should know that I think it would be great to come in here, grab a burger, go sit out there, go to Villa Dolce next door, get some gelato, walk over, people watch. And I don't think that those things just happen because a developer gives the property. But when it does happen is when we all come together as a community and say, this is an asset that we want going into the future, and we're going to work together to figure out how to make that happen. Whether it's selling bricks, fundraising, utilizing TIF to increase the property values that surround the site, these are all things that we need to explore. And there's no reason to throw it out until we've exhausted every opportunity to enhance the city in such a way.
You know, who doesn't like, I lived in Europe for 2 years. I have seen the plazas. I mean, you have seen the European cities. They have the center of the city where there are no cars, there are no, just the bikes and pedestrians. I know plazas. So, now, did City of Middleton have this in any plans? Of course not. This development comes out there, and the developer is asking, well, how about giving me $2 million here so that they can have a plaza here which can help his facility over there. I know it probably will be used by more than just the people in Middleton Center, but it wasn't set anywhere in the plans.
So every plan since 1970 for the city has...
No.
Don't interrupt. No. Let him finish.
...said we want it driving downtown.
No. Let him finish, please.
So what I like to see and what the city should do is that let's have a plan. Where do we want the plaza? How big the plaza we want? This site is 1/3 of an acre. And you want to spend $2 million? Those $2 million could be spent. That's it. Some of it could be a lot of it could be money. You could fix the University Avenue. You could fix the High Point Road. You could fix some of the other streets which are covered by the TIF money, rather than giving away that handout to one of the people here. So I guess I don't need to give any names. I don't want to. I always want to stay positive. So I think if we plan for it, I don't have any problem. If the developer was to give that land, and then the city does the planning. I don't think that I want to have that plaza there tomorrow. It will have to be prioritized. It has to be somewhere fit in the priorities, city's priorities, and then it could be 1 year, 2 years, 5 years. But roads will have to come first if you are using any of the TEF money. But even if you're not using the TEF money, it has to be in long-term plans. It should be in the city's best interest. It should be in the interest of the all the people around here, because we are talking about the downtown. You're not talking about some other nook and corner. So I think that's how I feel it. I feel that let's have a long-term plan and let's involve a lot more people, and it should help all the people, not just a small segment here. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you. Gurdeep, do you have a question that you would like to ask Hans?
Yes, I would be happy to. Now, the Middleton Times Tribune asked some of the questions, and Hans Hilbert said that one of his crowning accomplishments in the past 10 years was that he enabled that there was a conservancy subdivision which was coming up, that he enabled, he made it happen, that it did not happen, that it went away. And my question is that when I look at the city council minutes here, and so when the conservation ordinance was debated, Hans and I, along with the two other elder folks, it was tied 4-4. It was the mayor who broke the tie, and we have a conservancy ordinance. If those guys wanted to develop a conservancy division, there is your ordinance. So I don't really know what role he played there, and I can tell you the role which I played. Because I talked to some of the Pheasant Branch conservancy people, I talked to Dane County. I almost know a lot of history about the septic systems and all those wells more than I had wanted to know. And you know, I always do the research and look into it, and then I vote for it. And I voted against for the...
Do you have a question for Hans?
Yeah, that's the question. That yes, the question is that I don't see that what role he played there. So he says that was his crowning accomplishment, but I don't see in the city council minutes. It was on December 2nd, 2014, when we voted on it.
If you look at the minutes a couple months before that, you'll see that there was excitement about a new project on the west end of town, and it probably got unanimous support for the council to look into it. To say that I didn't do anything because the mayor broke a vote, I certainly got it to a point where the mayor would have a say in it, rather than, you know, a 7-1 on the council. I took every single line of chapter 19 apart. That's the subdivision ordinance that would have significantly changed how communities develop, or how the city of Middleton develops, whether we provide sanitary systems or well and septic. I didn't have to go out and do research to know that that was a bad idea. I have that background already. That's not something I needed to go ask the DNR or the county to provide me with. That was a pretty simple solution. Are pretty easy to come up with. I spent hours working on that conservation subdivision ordinance in case it did get approved, so that we would have the best conservation subdivision ordinance in the city. That would have been available for approval had the mayor broke the vote the other way. You could ask anybody that was on the council that time if they really knew much about conservation subdivisions and that process at the beginning, and they'd tell you they didn't know very much. And the ones that are supporting me anyways would tell you that they knew a heck of a lot more because of the work that I did and provided the policymakers of the city directly to make that decision.
Do you have a question for Gurdeep?
Yes. You say you created the sustainability committee. How come ever since you announced to be that you would be running in this campaign, you show up for the first 5 minutes of a meeting, you shake everybody's hand wearing a name tag that says mayor, and then you leave, and you don't stay around to listen to what the committees have to say and to help the committee grow the community?
And good question. First, to the just a couple of points about the conservancy thing. You know, you can go to the town of Middleton. They've got the septic tanks and their own well. So there's a lot known about there. So what I was doing was doing the overall study when you have certain kind of a soil, what happens, and if it's a sandy soil, heavy soil, and
you're not answering the question.
I'm coming to it. So, but I did want to, he had said some things which I didn't think was the accurate, and that's what I'm answering. So, I started the sustainability committee. There's no question about it. There were, I can tell you what really happened. So there was a George Zenz, and there were two other people, I think, one of the aldermen and Bill Allen. So the Mayor Doug Swank, he has started a little group to explore into whether or not we need sustainability committee. And what they had come out with was that we don't need, and George is here, he can tell you that too, that I don't think there's any need, and George reluctantly joined our committee to begin with, and Bob Allen didn't even join, and I'm the elder man there, so I spearheaded in finding the members to join that committee. I personally, you know, Angela and some of the others, so, and then I not only started the committee, I went around the neighborhood and asked them what they wanted in terms of projects. And there's a Peggy here, and she said the community gardens, and the Bach community garden originated because of that input. We looked at so many sites, and you also ran a 209 mayoral campaign, that community garden was one of the big issues, because one of the sites was a little off the Middleton Beach Road. And to answer the other point, that I come to the meetings and stay 5 minutes, I want to meet those people and I want to understand and what's going on. And that's, I don't have the time, you know, to go to every meeting. So I want to, you know, shake hands and get to know the people. And I come over there to meet people. So that's what I do. And I think wearing that tag, I don't see any problem with it. So. I mean, I'm running for mayor of Middleton, and if you made a tag broad for mayor, I don't see there's any issue, so.
All right. Are there any questions that you would like to ask either candidate or both candidates? Please. The question is, Gurdeep. Why did Gurdeep vote against the stormwater utility?
Great question. Thank you, Elder West. I'm happy to answer this. So actually, I give the credit to Elder West. She's the one who initiated that let's have a stormwater utility. I have nothing against the stormwater utility to begin with, but I wanted it to be done right. So what was happening was that when we started with the stormwater utility, they came up that we will have a $50 per house as a fee. And not only that, they wanted that the city council could raise that anytime they wanted to. And then Joanna and myself, we fought for it. And then what we ended up in the end was that there was a $15 per unit as a fee per year, and it has to go to the referendum if you want to raise it. So I voted for it when it was approved, and I think it was right for the city. I know there are some people, they are looking for, hey, let's find money. So let's have a little bit more taxes. I care for the people, and I think, yes, we need money to run this city, We have to pay for the services that we get. And by the way, this city is run well. This is a great city. We are getting wonderful services, and I don't mind paying for it. But I don't want where they say, where you are hitting the citizens one time, and then you don't even know where that money is going and what's happening. So I voted for it when it was properly formulated, and we went to the referendum, and I'm happy with what we have now.
It was never proposed to be a $50
fee. I have papers to prove it. I have reams of paper, and I will be happy to. I can show you in the city council meeting, and I can show you some of the other material. I don't want to start a discussion here. If anybody wants the information, I'd be happy to send it.
Any other question? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Hans, you speak to your powers of rhetoric and persuasion, and I have seen that in the Zoning Board of Appeals, and I have seen where a neighborhood filled the room to oppose a project, and yet you persuaded the Zoning Board of Appeals to go against the neighborhood feeling. And I would like to know how you think that is in the best public interest.
I've never served on the Zoning Board of Appeals. I've never tried to persuade that process. It's a quasi-judicial committee. It's appointed by the mayor. It's not made up of elected officials. And they have a very clear role of making a decision based on hardship for property owners. So I've persuaded the council in many ways, but never the Zoning Board of Appeals. I'll talk about stormwater and the stormwater utility. That is a fee. When the city collects a fee, there is a very specific purpose of what that fee can be used for as opposed to taxes. If anyone's confused about what that fee is being paid for, we have a very clear plan of where those dollars are going. I started 10 years ago, and I was immediately appointed to water resources because I had a background in the area. I saw immediately that because stormwater management and the maintenance of stormwater management facilities was not a sexy city service, that it was always going to be put dead last priority. Even though the federal government, the state government, the county all has requirements that we maintain these, it was really going to be up to us to come to a together as a community to figure out how we're going to protect Pheasant Branch Conservancy, how we're going to reduce 80 million tons of phosphorus from polluting Lake Mendota. And year after year for budgets, I would raise this concern, and I started talking to people like Susan West and Jim Wexler and Mark Sullivan when he came around and really helped us hammer out some of the financial issues that we were having at the city, and said, this is the process that we need to go through to make this right, because it's never going to get approved in a city budget on an annual basis to continue to do the things that are right and what the community wants us to be working on.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, sir. The question is the long-term visions for the city library.
Okay, well, you want me to start? We have a wonderful library. I love it. We came here in 1982, and here's my son and my daughter. We used it extensively. I remember when this library was where the city hall is now. It was part of it. And I also remember when we had this. I also remember when we had this wonderful library, and it's a great facility. And so now the question is that has it overgrown in terms of use, and we need a new library? Well, there are some areas which are lacking. We had one study done in 2013 that for the younger kids, there isn't really a big room, and it's crowded. And the way the library is handling now is they are having more than one session. So there are some areas which are the study, they rank them from A, B, and C, and we were getting, I don't know, 7 out of 10, it was ranked 8. But there are some areas which are lacking. But then there's the other situation. We got to plan that how the libraries are changing. It's becoming a meeting place. There are libraries where there are coffee shops. It's like a meeting. You could even have a conference. Well, we have a conference room, but we need more of that service. So what we need here now is not just the library the way it is now, how the libraries would be 20 years from now. We're in an internet age. What would be people needing at that time? So we have to start thinking about it. And I would like it to be a part of the bigger vision that the Civic Center, you know, which the city has been thinking about it, that having the city hall, senior center, the convention, you know, meeting rooms, and the library. So I think that's how I will put this library in a bigger picture, and that would be the way to go. So, and also, not just for this to happen, and I have been begging a lot of those folks in the library, we need a much larger input, not just from the people, we also need an input from what's happening in Massachusetts, what's happening in Boston, what's happening in California, how are the libraries changing? So let's have a complete picture, I think you have to spend money at some stage, but you spend the money for the right thing, which is going to stay there for a long, long time.
Boy, I really have to answer this question correctly because my partner is a librarian. So if I don't, I might get thrown out of my own house. But first of all, the library board, and through state statute, the library board is the governing body for the library. As a mayor, I'll take a high priority in making sure that we have a great library board, because it's going to be up to them to tell the city what the needs of the library are. I can't keep up with the evolving trends and the needs of the library, but I know that the people that work at the Middleton Public Library and the members of the library board and the friends of the library, they all know that. And I'm going to rely heavily on them to hand City Hall a document that says, this is what we need to provide the best quality library service in the state of Wisconsin. And the city's going to take that and we're going to say, we're going to develop a civic campus to address these needs. Or we're going to create a satellite location so that we're reaching all of the patrons of the library, from, you know, 3-year-olds just learning to read up to seniors that need help or assistance with their computers or just need a place to go and spend during the day. So we're lucky to have Paul Nelson, who was our library director, I believe, for 26 years, go on to give time back to the county board. We have the support of the county board. We can get the support of the state to help us fund these projects. But it's also going to be the city working with the private sector to create partnerships. One of the evolving trends is libraries is that people want to go to a library that's in a dynamic setting. And we can make those partnerships happen, but we're going to rely on our great library staff and board to tell us what they need.
I'll you'll have the opportunity again later if there's no more questions from you. Any other questions?
Yes.
Oh, yes, sir.
Do you this is for both of you. Do you see or anticipate a parking problem in downtown Middleton? And if so, what do you look
for? The question is, for both candidates, do you anticipate a parking problem in downtown Middleton? And if so, what are you going to do about it? Gurdeep, you want to take it first?
I sure hope so, because if people are coming down here and parking here, that means that they're going to the new development across the street, that they're living there, that they're eating in the restaurants there, that they're coming to the Village Green, that they're coming to the plaza next door. If there aren't any cars here, then we're going to have big problems. Now, when more people want to come here than we allow, we need to look as a city holistically of how we address that going forward. Our current parking study, and we've studied parking and circulation in the downtown at least four times in the last 20 years, and it says when properties redevelop, put the parking for that demand on that property. There's been a lot of interest in the city providing a parking ramp to address this needs, and it's just not economical to do that when we can work with developers to answer those parking situations as we go through development processes. Transit, parking, mobilization, it's a very dynamic topic, especially now when we start looking at automated driverless cars and Uber services and shared cars and a strong interest in the bicycle community to have good public bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure. All of these things come together to help alleviate the need for parking. It really is a wasted space to create parking lots when we have streets and streets of pavement that can be parked on. It's going to be part of a changing culture to expect that you're going to get your exercise by walking a couple blocks to get to where you need to go so that we can have a thriving downtown, like every plan since 1970 for this downtown has said we want to have. It doesn't specifically say put a parking lot here or put a plaza there, but when we have experts in the field saying this will address your parking situation, this will make your business community thrive, we need to explore those things and implement them. But we're not gonna, tear down the old pet milk factory to put a parking lot so then we can develop. We have to interact with the development process. We need to interact with the dynamics of how this is changing, and we're gonna get through it. The problem's a good problem to have.
It's a good question. I think this question has been looked into two, three times in the past. We have one of the group called Walker. They come up with we have some Walker studies. He's supposed to be the national expert. It's interesting that they come up with that we don't really have a parking problem, but the people who actually come downtown, they do find a problem. They find problem parking. And part of that is that the people want to park close to where the restaurant is or wherever they want to go. That is one part of the problem. But concern which I have is the new development. The city required that they should have 531 parking spots by the city ordinance. But what has happened is through the Walker and the other discussions that there could be a shared parking. That means during the day, the people who are living in the apartments, they go to work, and those people who are coming for shopping and the others, they will be able to use those slots. And I'm concerned that if whether or not that will work and that if that would create a bigger problem. So I'm concerned about that one, that what we have come up with, that shared parking, whether or not it will work and would create a bigger problem for us. And also to begin with, it was my understanding that since we were giving tax money to the developer, that the folks coming here will be able to use some of those parking places. It didn't happen. So now they could still use it, but they have to pay for it. So I think, the jury's out. So it's possible that in the end, the city might end up using a TIF money and build a parking ramp. Though we looked at the parking ramp, it has other problems. So to answer your question, the jury's out. So we may or may not have a problem, but it likely we will. So.
Yes.
Just this past November, Middleton established itself as a national leader in in the crisis of climate change, global warming. They unanimously approved two questions on a referendum. That referendum gave them a chance to declare, they declared unanimously climate change needs to be addressed with a carbon fee and dividend plan, and the city was endorsing it through that referendum question. And secondly, there was a question, should the city of Middleton itself, in its policies and decisions, consider the impact of climate change and global warming on what they do and how they do it? What are the top three things either of you would propose doing to take that sentiment to address that crisis into action?
No, climate change.
Good. You want me to start it or? Well, good question. You did a great job in providing the leadership. Let's give him a big hand here. Really a great job, Dan. So, well, our sustainability committee has been providing a leadership in this area. So, and I'm sure they are going to do more of it. One of the things which you could do is the which we are already doing, that on the municipal center we have the solar panels. We also got on the police stations, and we could do more of it. And the second thing, which we actually just did now, is we are changing the purchasing policy so that whatever things we are a city going forward may be buying, they will look at that they are produced by the sustainable features. And then the other thing which I could mention is that our sustainability committee has already started some of the other initiative, for example, even the water use and some of the other issues. So they all impact on our overall environment.
Kermit, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to sign the letter that's already written to federal and state politicians that says, look what we said in Middleton. Overwhelmingly, we thank you. We support initiatives at the federal and the municipal level to combat the negative effect of global warming and climate change. And it's going to start here. We're going to take in a proposal from a developer who's requesting TIF for other city subsidies or partnerships, and we're going to say, what are you doing in your development and plan to make sure that the city's goals and objectives related to the carbon footprint of the city are being minimized? We're going to take a look at every dollar that we spend in the city of Middleton for a sustainable purchasing plan. By the way, if you want to look at minutes, you can look about a month ago, and you'll see I deferred the approval of that of the purchasing plan because it wasn't right. You couldn't hand it to a city staff member and say, implement this. I took the time to work with the consultant, to work and hear what the sustainability committee had to say when I stayed for the meeting for 2 hours to really hear and interact with the committee members to make sure that we had a really good sustainable purchasing plan and that we had a really good sustainability plan when we approved that back in 2010. I know you wanted three. We're gonna continue to look at...
I want more, really.
I'm only gonna talk for three, but we're gonna continue to investigate the potential out at the airport to put one of the most state-of-the-art solar systems in. We're gonna look at the library. It'll be part of the civic campus. It'll be a part of the buildings on the west side of the Beltline to see where we can get solar and where it makes sense. Good question.
Yes, sir.
Yes, both of you addressed the need for workforce housing. So, similar question. Three specific things you think we should be doing in the next 3 to 5 years to address issues of workforce housing.
Question about three things to do to address the issue of workforce housing.
Well, so the workforce housing, as I said earlier, is a difficult issue in Middleton. And I can give you the reasons for it. Number one is the land in Middleton is very expensive. So the one way to really address this issue, and which we have been doing and we probably should keep it doing, and which Hans actually voted against it, which is to have apartments just like Meadowwood, and just like Heritage Housing, and just like Oakwood, which are the new ones coming up. I think it is a good idea to keep up with that one. And the second part will be that we also have the west side apartments here, 240 apartments, and we also have given some of the TIF assistance. It will not be affordable housing. They don't have the VIDA credit, but we are giving the TIF money, and they will provide 23 units for the next 15 years. And we have also used that approach for the Cardinal Crest condo apartments here. They will have one unit. So these are the two approaches which we have used, and it will be really nice if we could find some way developing single family homes also in an affordable way. And maybe you're an expert, you can tell us, but or maybe advise us sometime. But that is something which is a very difficult thing in Middleton too. And I will work on this and see that if we can somehow find a solution to single family homes, which could also be affordable. And by the way, I like the people who work in Middleton to be able to live in Middleton. We have over 18,000 jobs. There are only 3,000 people, between 2,500 and 3,000 people who actually live and work in Middleton. It's about time we change this. Thank you.
You just heard about a lot of great things I've really worked hard to make happen in the last 10 years. Those were things that are already done. The question is what we're gonna do into the future. The first thing, I think the most important thing that we can do it to help people get into homes and to be able to afford leases is to establish a revolving loan fund. This is the top priority of the City of Middleton's workforce housing strategy. And I sat on the committee and I went to the meetings and we worked really hard to put this together. We don't have to think about what we're gonna do, we need to implement the plan. Revolving fund, private and public partnerships with the federal government, with the state government. We need to pool our resources because it's going to be the only way that it's going to make it affordable. We can talk workforce housing, we can talk affordable housing. One thing he said that's correct is that land values are expensive in Middleton. Why? Because we love to live here. If we can provide that opportunity across the entire workforce, we're going to have a greater community, because that touches on every aspect of the community. We're going to work with single family developers, and we're going to say, okay, you build single family homes and you give the city some land so that we can do economic development. Because like I said in the opening statement, and it was running short, the housing stock for workforce housing and affordable housing is the easy solution. We bring three or four developers into the room and we say, we want these products, here's the land, build them for us. The other thing is having the economic development that brings in corporations like Fiskars North American headquarters, Mead and Hunt, ETC, so many others that have really high paying jobs that create the service industry around those jobs where the workforce housing gaps exist. If we can continue to bring in the really good jobs, that's going to bring up the wages of the service industry. So we're providing the product, we're increasing the wages, and we're forming partnerships to obtain land, to work with the developers to provide all of those.
Yes, sir.
Just a couple of things. One is, the Middleton Library, I think, is a very fine facility, and I don't see any glaring deficiencies there. As far as parking is concerned, parking is always an issue. But for me, the biggest parking issue is trying to get out of the parking lot at the library and turn left on Hubbard, where you have to stop and say a prayer because you can't see traffic coming from Parmenter. I mean, that is an atrocious situation. But here's my question, which is a big picture question. What I'd like to know is, when you look around at what's going on in downtown Middleton, the scale of the development is dramatically changing. You're seeing 4- and 5-story buildings now, big footprints. I would like to hear both of you talk about what your vision is for Middleton 10, 20, 30 years down the road. Where you want it to go and how you're going to get it there.
The question is about the scale of development in Middleton that is becoming bigger, 4- or 5-story houses. The question to the two candidates is what their vision is for the next 10, 20 years, where they see Middleton going, development-wise, I assume.
My background is in planning, so when you start talking vision, this could take the rest of the night, but I'll try to be somewhat succinct. I was actually talking about this with Eileen Kelly over lunch today, our city planning director, and my vision for the library, the city hall site, started a number of years ago when I realized the city hall is not adequate. There's going to be need for expanded meeting spaces in the downtown. Additional libraries. We're going to need to pool together our resources, get the senior center into the same building as the city hall and the library so we can reduce our carbon footprint. So I started looking, and when you start moving the pieces around, and there's no right answer, but I do have a vision. And I see a large central park on the parcels that are currently parking lots and city hall. I see combining a lot of the city services that are offered to residents in the downtown on the current library and parking lot site. The city's, and I've said this before, the city is really the only entity that's foolish enough to try to somehow bridge the railroad and do a go under or go above to really maximize the limited amount of land we have. Eileen and I were talking, and this hit me last week, and I said, you know, there might not be a need for Hubbard to extend from Middleton Street all the way to Parmenter. That's additional land that the city could revitalize. We don't necessarily need a road in front of the historic museum or the library. We could address, if we make large visionary changes like that, or at least have plans of how those things might look, we can address the issues of not being able to pull out of the library. It doesn't always have to be like that. So I really see, you know, maximizing the existing land that's off the tax bases for those purposes, have a Central Park or a Middleton Park in downtown that, you know, maybe is big enough to have an athletic field or to host events or community gatherings, that it serves different purposes than a public plaza. And we can pay for those things if we take the Senior Center, if we take the Hubbard Avenue Art Center out of these buildings that the CDA built and put them into a building that we're going to build anyways, we can, you know, open up those spaces for new leases and use that revenue to provide to implement some of these things. So not only do I have a vision, but I'm also seeing where these finances might come from. And it really starts to transition from the single family neighborhood into a thriving downtown. One thing about the scale of development, anytime a developer acquires a large chunk of land, which we don't have very many of down here, it's going to be a bigger scale. The smaller pieces are going to fill in at a scale that balances out that neighborhood.
So if I could ask you a question, you are really asking only for the downtown, not for a larger area. Is that true?
Yeah, primarily downtown.
Primarily downtown. So. I looked at the cities. City had a master plan, which they had put together in 2006, and they are in the process of updating that master plan. So in that master plan, what they have so far is that as far as single family homes are concerned, that's going to be a Bishop Bay development, and then rest will be infill development. So that means there are some areas here. So you could have development there as well. That's what the city is putting together. So to actually go back, there are a lot of people who actually like the way the downtown Milton looked. I mean, including my wife. It looked sort of gave a small city feeling. It was a beautiful place, but that's the cat out of the bag, so that's not going back there. So what is the area which is still, you know, could be developed. We are sitting there, one of them. And then there's the area between Elmwood and the University Avenue. The second part is, again, the Civic Center, which Hans mentioned as well, combining library, and I had said it before. So I don't think that there are too many areas there where you could have the same level of development that we are doing there. So I think that's the way I see it. So.
Yes, sir.
I'm curious about your thoughts about the city of Middleton and kind of the context of the greater metro and, you know, areas that you might see for multi-jurisdictional cooperation, or just generally, what is your understanding of the city of Middleton's place in the Madison metro area?
The question is, how do they see Middleton's place in the greater Madison area as far as multi-jurisdictional entities are concerned?
Well, I could start. I guess you probably know that Middleton was ranked number one city in of its size in the U.S. So as far as the whole metropolitan area is concerned, we are pretty well recognized. And also, Middleton Public Library in 2007 was also picked as the number one library in Wisconsin. So I don't exactly know what you're precisely looking into, that how the Middleton will influence Madison, or Madison influence Middleton, or the other areas. So in terms of the interaction with the other surrounding cities, for example, we have an agreement with Westport, and we do things together, including the Bishop Bay development, and we got similar agreement with the town of Middleton. And you know, the as a city, the developments which happen within the 3 mile from that our border or some distance, so you have the city has the authority to, you know, to be able to cooperate and discuss those things. So as far as Madison is concerned, they are very reliant. We are very fortunate that we have all those facilities in Madison which we can use. And we love going to Overture Center and so many other things, and State Street. So I think Madison provides wonderful facilities, and that enables even having our higher bond rating as well. So I think, Madison is a great place, and it's helping us as well.
I think that when I look at multi-jurisdictional, and I did once try to change the name of the Greater Madison Visitor and Convention Bureau to the Middleton Convention Bureau, and it didn't work. I was voted down. But when I look at those types of partnerships, I look at what already exists, where we're coming together. And it's economic development. We need to continue to focus that on the region as a whole. Anytime that economic development happens in the 9-county region, it benefits us all. And we have, you know, research to show that. We look at tourism. Anytime that an amenity is created, whether it's within our boundaries or somewhere else, and people want to come here and do that or see that or be there, we have the same amount of hotel rooms that the Isthmus does. So where are they going to stay? They're going to stay in Middleton because we have great amenities, and it's easy to get in and out. You can come here, you can go to the House on the Rock, and we need to maintain the partnerships that let us market ourselves in that way and that really promote us as the region. The third place where I see the multi-jurisdictional coming in, and we've tried before, but we need to keep working at it, is transportation. I serve on the 2050 MPO policy committee for planning. It's the plan that has to be in place to accept federal money for transportation projects. There's really scary numbers in that report, like to have public transportation in the year 2050, between now and then we need to spend $305 million. The city of Madison is the only entity putting money towards those capital expenses, and they're only putting $6 million a year. We need to come together as a region to make those connections. Otherwise, the city of Madison is going to say, we're not going outside our borders. We're going to service the city. but we can maintain the great relationships and enhance them. So that's really where I see multi-jurisdictional.
Yes, sir.
What is your long-term vision for the airport?
Long-term vision for the airport.
The airport is the only one in, I believe, Wisconsin. If Howard's here, he'll tell me if I'm right or wrong. But only airport, municipal airport in Wisconsin that's fully self-funded. None of the general fund or tax dollars go to support the operations out at Maury Field. And because of that, we have Mead and Hunt, one of the nation's premier airport engineer firms, that said we're going to have our headquarters in Middleton because they have a great airport. There's other industries that rely heavily on the airport. We need to continue to build capacity to house the businesses that function directly at the airport and house the airplanes. We need to expand the runway so that insurance companies will insure the jets that are parked out there. And we need to work with our neighbors up in the town of Springfield, in the town of Middleton, to make sure that they're aware of our development plans and that the airport is going to be a function of our urban area. And we don't have to get in the fight that we had when the city purchased the airport. People living in the town of Middleton complaining that there's more airplanes coming in and there's more noise, but they're also coming to our wonderful library and benefiting from the fact that these companies are creating tax base and providing the services that they're using. So long-term planning to make sure that the airport stays as successful as it is today.
Well, I'm in the airport commission, so I'm sort of up to date what's happening and what the long-term plans are. So one of the things which Hans mentioned as well, that we have run out of hangars. So we are doing a master study that where could we put more hangars. So that's one of the big things which is happening right now, developing a master plan, because all these things have to be approved by the federal agencies. So this airport is, you know, sort of a self-funded in the sense that the hangars pay the fee and that helps run the airport. Now, as far as do you want to make the runway longer? Do you want to put the other runway as well? There are a lot of people who would rather not. I remember that when the airport was being built, my son actually supported it, that we should keep this as a green space, and he's here. And so I think it's a catch-22. The people who are living in the neighborhood, they don't really like the noise. And I am for the people. I think if we want to expand the runway, we got to involve people. We got to have a big hearing. We got to get their input. So I think I don't mind if the people living around in the neighborhood, they can put up with the noise and they think that let's expand the runway. But you know, just to have an excuse that there's a insurance reasons, you know, you can always find excuses to do something. But you know, I'm not really sure if how far that's true. It has been discussed at the airport commission, some of those issues. So I think looking out into the future, I would see that this is a very nice airport. It's well maintained. And if we want to expand the runway, those who have the planes, they of course would want to do that. But the others who don't, well, I guess they don't want to have that noise and stuff. So it's a catch-22.
I have another question for both candidates. As a mayor, you're the figurehead of the city and you're the public face, and it's a prestigious office, but the mayor by himself or herself doesn't get anything done. You need the city council makes the decisions, staff implements them, staff does a lot of work. With all your visions and ideas, and how do you expect to get them implemented? Gertie.
All right, so he's absolutely right. So the mayor exerts or his or her influence in multiple ways. Number one is the mayor gets to point the people to the committees. Most of the work which happens in the city is happening in the committee. So whether it's a sustainability committee or it's a public works committee, so a lot of that work happens behind the scenes. So you want to point great people, and we do have a lot of great people on those committees. And then whenever the new things are coming, they are first coming to the city administrator, they are not coming to the mayor. And then the city administrator, of course, will bring to the attention of the mayor. So in my case, I think, I'm willing to spend time to look and explore all those issues very carefully, work with the city administrator, work with the staff, and even work with the committees. And of course, finally, you have to work with the city elder folks as well. So one thing which we all share, whether we are the elders or the city staff or the mayor, that we love this city. We are interested in the best interest of the city. So I think, I will exert my influence through the committees, working with the staff, and with the city council.
The work at City Hall is done by city staff. The council, the mayor, the committees tell them what that work needs to be. We set policy. We rely heavily on a very shoestring staff. As mayor, the first thing I would do if I could would be make Mike Davis sign a 20-year contract because he and our department heads are the lifeblood of what make the city look good. Working with council members and listening to the committees, we need to formulate our plan of what we're going to tell staff to do. We need to let them do their jobs. We need to let them be creative. We need to make sure that they're staying on course. We need to be there to back them up when there's a developer in the room demanding that it be something else, and we say, that's not our goal. We'll take the next developer, please. And we need to put together in the next 2 years a comprehensive city labor personnel strategy, because we have needs to increase staff and to provide more services and to continue to provide the services we have now. What I'd like to do is work with the finance committee, work with the personnel committee, sit down, have very long discussions, work with the department head, say what are the top priorities, and when we have that, come back to the voters and say, we need a referendum, much like the stormwater utility. Will you support this to allow us to staff the city so it's adequate to provide the services at the level that the community expects?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Zenz, you outlined how the city should work with your way you described the different duties. But maybe I live on a cynical block, but I'm wondering if it really does work that way. That is to say that the staff implements the vision that the people have brought to their representatives. Because when I read the paper and learned about this proposed civic center, the vision seemed to be coming from the staff. And like I said, maybe I live on a cynical block, but then you talk to the neighbors and they say, okay, yeah, of course. When the firefighters needed a new place, they got that. And then when the medical people saw what the firefighters got, they got a new one. And then when the police saw what they got, they wanted a new one. And to a cynic, it looks like the—
Do you have a question?
Yes, sir. It looks like now maybe it's City Hall's turn to follow suit. And so my question is, because this may be a single issue vote for me, which of you candidates can convince me that this plan is not already decided, but will be decided upon by a deliberative process? And can you give me your bet, if you favor it, what are the reasons why I should want it as a way to spend our tax dollars? What is the best convincing argument for this civic center that it will serve the people and not the other way around.
We hear all the time from the community, the service groups, ourselves, that we need things like meeting spaces, and we lost the use of it at the fire department, or the library has a policy that only lets your group meet once a year. I think that's what really drives us to work at the committee level to say, hey, staff, work on this for us. Bring us back, give us the tools to make a decision whether we're going to support this. And if we support things, we're representing your interests in that. What's really going to drive the plan, though, is going to be to why this needs to happen is because it's sustainable. We need to implement our sustainability so we can afford to operate into the future.
Great question. Sustainable is a good word. Just use it wherever you want it. But I like working with people. I will bring the city government to the people. We will have a listening session in the neighborhood. Then we will have a neighborhood meetings as well. And we will determine what the needs are. We will get your input. And I would actually be coming there to get input as well. And we will also provide, I guess there's some mechanism, even more mechanism, that you should be able to provide some of the input to the city staff as well. So we will make it as an open government rather than just one or two people deciding it, rather than just one or two people having a stronghold there on the city hall. It will be the government of our people. It will be a lot more transparent, a lot more open, a lot more input from all citizens here. That's my vision. My vision is the people getting their more input and involving them more into this process.
Yes, ma'am.
Vision or ideas are for creating that and fostering that in this community, and your ideas on immigration and policing and minority-owned business development.
Well, that's... Well, it's not an easy question. As you know that there isn't much of minority here. And even if you were to look at the city hall or, you know, I don't really know, maybe police chief would know if we have any employees of color among the city employees. I know we have one Hispanic or some of those ones. So it's not an easy thing to do. It's not that, for example, the police department, they have tried to recruit them, but it's hard to find them. So, but the question is, again, it's a wider question, how to make it an inclusive community. Well, one of the things is a lot of the minorities, they are not as well off, so that means they can't afford to buy a house here. So affordable housing is part of the solution. There are probably other ways one could go about improving this. The other will be improving the environment, having meetings, seminars, or discussions. But, you know, it's a very, even, well, I'm a minority here. So came here in 1982, and maybe at that time I was probably the first one who was from India or moving into Middleton, and we moved because we love the pond. So I guess it's a difficult situation. The minorities have to make an effort as well to get to know people and involve in the community, and the city probably has some role to play as well. not just the city per se, maybe all the departments in the city should make an effort that how can we be more inclusive. And well, could we have some way of influencing the businesses as well to do this? I don't know, that may be possible as well. But it's a great question. I know San Francisco is an awesome place. My daughter lives there. But it requires more discussion, more communication, more thinking. And you have to start the process. And I think by asking that question, you have started the process. Thank you for your question.
I'm a minority myself. And it's proof that it doesn't have a color and it doesn't have a face. And I think that there's a lot of minorities probably sitting in this room. It's an issue that we're not allowed to turn our back on. We're a pluralistic society. We have people of all beliefs. We have people of all economic backgrounds. And the best thing that we can do is come together as a community, work out any issues that exist, in order to move forward. It's going to involve, and it does involve, the religious community, the LGBTQ community, the police department, the senior center, fire department, EMS, anyone that provides a service in the city, the business community. It's going to take all of us coming together. We have one of the most professional police departments that I've ever experienced. We have men and women, we have minorities on our police force that go out every day and they will do whatever it takes to make sure that I get to go home and be safe at night. They go out and they're proactive. They stop the problems before they're created. They form a relationship between the school district and the police department when we have things that happen in public parks that people don't like. We're already doing a lot of these things. We're going to continue to do them because we're going to get more diverse and we're going to be more cultural as a result of it.
Hey, let's get a big hand to talk here. Great police chief here. Awesome.
If there are no more questions, then, oh, sir, yes?
How do you describe your political leanings between conservatives and progressives?
Well, it's a non-partisan, and I think, that's how I would like it to stay. So what I like to do is I want to serve all people, doesn't matter what their political leanings are, and I actually mean it. And that's exactly what I do. I don't look, I don't ask them whether they are Republican or Democrat or progressive, and I don't answer that question too. Sometimes, somebody says, they come, how did you vote? Well, yeah. I don't even tell my wife how I voted. It's a decision which I make and it stays with me. And so I think that's how I am. So it's, it's a non-partisan and that's how I treat it.
I'm an independent. I've never been a member of one party or the other. I think you have to look at each election, each policy decision on its own merits. And the most important thing to me is, regardless of who we put in a higher position to work on our behalf, is that they actually work together and get something done.
All right, I would like, I'm going to ask each of the candidates to make a closing statement. But before that, I would like to thank all of you for coming. I apologize for the audio, and thank you to our sponsors again. You had the opening statement.
Okay.
I'm going to start with a closing statement.
Okay.
All right. Get cracking.
www.hanshilbert.com. I'm on Facebook too, you can get there, it's all connected. It's a really nice website. I use my own images or stock images. I didn't steal them from other websites. I didn't violate ethics codes to make the website by putting a big city logo up there. It's a great website, check it out. One of my opponent's third priority that he put down on his literature and wrote was that he wanted to get young people involved. And I see what he's doing right now is how I feel I've seen him do for the last 8 years whenever we're trying to make progress, and that's putting up a wall and allowing somebody like myself who is younger. There aren't a lot of 33-year-olds. I was 23 when I was elected to the council. There aren't a lot of 23-year-olds that grew up in the same house all their life till they went to school that had two parents in that house the whole time. I think there's things that make me a little unique and cut out to be your leader. To stand in the way of a young person who's interested, who has the support of 16 past and present city council members, has the support of the outgoing mayor, what really is the priority? I want to do this so that I can give back. It's not because I woke up one day and said, I want to be mayor, and it's not going to be a status thing. It's about being able to make this a better place, because when I'm still here in 20 and 30 years, I want to make sure it's the best community that I can age in and retire into. Thank you.
To begin with, I create no walls. I love young people, I love old people, I love all people. I started Key Club at Middleton High School and it has 200 members. It has been going there for since 1994. Thousands of kids have graduated and they have learned about leadership. I am not creating walls. To begin with, Middleton is a great place to live and raise a family. I have known many of you in the community in the past 34 years. I work hard to get things done. My passion is to help people and make Middleton even a better place than it is today. I always have and always will put the citizens first. It's the Middleton people which will come first for me all the time. On April 4th, I'm asking for your vote. Together, we will make a difference. Thank you for coming, and let's say Milton is great. Thank you, thank you, thank you.